Well, I am the president of the Brennan Center for Justice at NYU Law School, and we do a lot of work on the Constitution, on voting rights, on a whole host of constitutional issues. But after the Newtown massacre, you know, once again the country was discussing and debating gun laws and gun control for the first time in a long time. But this was the very first time that this debate happened when there was an individual right to gun ownership recognized by the Supreme Court. Suddenly the Second Amendment was in the middle of the debates. And so I wanted to understand what the story was, what the history was, how did it come to be seen this way, and tell that story. And I learned a ton about that history myself as I was researching it. It was really very interesting for me, at the very least. So, you know, the Second Amendment says a well-regulated militia, comma, being necessary to the security of a free state, comma, the right of the people to keep and bear arms, comma, shall not be infringed. It starts off right there with a lot of confusion and a lot of clauses and a lot of commas. It was put into the Constitution because people were fearful, among other things, that the new central government created by the Constitution would crush the 13 state militias. They were really important to the people back then. The militias were, every adult white man had to be in a militia for their entire life, and they were required to own a gun and keep it at home and bring it in for their militia service. It's very different from anything we know now. So they thought they were protecting the militias. Over time, the country changed. We stopped having those militias. We grew more individualistic. Obviously, there were a lot of people with guns, and at the same time, there were a lot of gun laws and gun control laws all the way through. And the Second Amendment was not seen as limiting those gun laws. Several times, the Supreme Court didn't rule or ruled that the Second Amendment was about militias, not about individual gun rights. It wasn't until 2008, in a case called District of Columbia versus Heller, that the Supreme Court ruled for the first time that the Second Amendment referred to an individual right to gun ownership. I was interested in how did that change happen, and it turned out it happened the way constitutional change always happens. A long-term drive by citizens, in this case the NRA and its allies, to change how we saw the Constitution. They were very effective over many years. And that's the world we live in now as we're grappling with gun violence and what to do about it. Well, you could say that that would be a different Supreme Court case like Citizens United. I don't think the NRA got this constitutional change because of its money. It's a big group. It's got a few million members. But if you think about it, you know, AARP has many more, 30 million. The NRA and its allies, they won this because of intensity. Because they were intense, and they will vote for politicians yes or no based on this issue. And because they focused on making this gun issue a constitutional crusade, it was really about, for them, I think, about winning in the court of public opinion before winning in the court of law. And that's not how lawyers often want to think about it. They often think that the way you win is with the best brief or the best argument. But it really matters how the public, broadly speaking, sees these things. I was President Bill Clinton's director of speech writing for 4 years when he was president. And I learned a great deal about how he, coming from a state like Arkansas, where the hunting culture was so, you know, powerfully embedded in the state and everybody hunted there, you know, he understood how deep the gun culture was in parts of the country and how important it was to try to talk to those hunters about the gun laws of that time in a way that people would understand their rights were not being taken away. That is grown even more intense as a challenge, you know, because nowadays people are less worried, I think, about hunting than about this idea that the government, big government, is going to come take their guns away. I think you're right. I think there are almost two different worlds. People who live in rural areas say, look, you know, if I call the police, it'll take them 40 minutes to show up. Anyway, I need this to protect myself. Of course, how much crime are they really having to protect themselves against? In cities, it seems to me, the circumstances are very different, that there's a real risk of violence cascading out of control. And, you know, look, we're all very focused and horrified by these recent school shootings and the senselessness of some of these mass murders. But of course, there's shootings every day. There's violence every day, especially in cities. And we ought to be thinking about how we can stop that kind of violence that plagues, inner cities all over the country or urban areas. That to me is one of the reasons it's a mistake and was a mistake for the Supreme Court to get involved. This is the kind of thing that's better dealt with, I think, the balancing that has to happen between rights and public good and responsibility. That's better done by legislatures, by city governments, without being told that a judge is going to come in and strike down your law because somebody thinks that James Madison wouldn't have approved of it. I don't think, so the case, this case, Heller, I don't think there's much likelihood that it's going to be overturned, and I don't think people really are pushing for that. I think instead that, you can have gun rights, but like all rights, they're limited. And we have limitations on all rights, and the public good has to have its place too. So I think that real clarity, that whatever gun rights there may be, that when the public safety is threatened by something like assault weapons, then we have the ability to pass those laws. One of the interesting things, and I've learned, my own expertise is up until this point, really, I didn't know the world of guns terribly well. I really worked on campaign finance reform, voting rights, and other things, other aspects of constitutional law. It's really striking that this year, more people will be killed in the United States by guns than by cars. Now, at one level, that's a horrifying statistic. No other industrial country, no other developed country has anything close to that level of gun violence. But that's, in a way, not what's most interesting. What's most interesting is cars used to kill more people. What happened? Well, they didn't seize all the cars. They didn't unconstitutionally come in and take away the cars or ban driving. They made cars safer. They put in airbags and seatbelts, and they raised the drinking age, and they lowered the speed limit, and used technology, and all these other things that, in fact, have made cars much safer now and kill many fewer people than they used to. There are things like that that could be done with guns, with smart guns, with other kinds of technology, as long as the Second Amendment fundamentalism that says you can't have any limits on guns of any kind, as long as that fundamentalism doesn't get in the way. So I'm cautiously optimistic, as long as we don't let a misguided approach to the Constitution keep us from doing the right thing. It turns out that the way we interpret the Second Amendment is just like the way we understand all the rest of the Constitution. It's not because of some pristine text. It's always the push and pull and the rough and tumble of political advocacy and public agitation. It's always a great debate. And, on the Second Amendment, but this was true for slavery, this was true for the fight for civil rights, it's true for marriage equality now, if you think about that, or any of these other big issues that come before the Supreme Court. The decision, yes, the Supreme Court gets to decide, but ultimately it's really up to the public. The public makes constitutional law throughout American history every bit as much as judges and lawyers do. That was definitely the case with the Second Amendment. It's also going to be the case with stronger gun laws and all these other issues. I think carrying around the Constitution and the Declaration of Independence is a great idea. And, there are lots of organizations that print them up. And there are phone apps, which is how I carry it around.